Good morning, students. Welcome to the online teaching session of Academic World School Pemitra. I hope that you all are feeling well as you are concentrating over your studies. This is the third video lecture of chapter number 3, Economic Reforms 1991. I hope that you have watched the first video lecture as well as second video lecture of chapter number 3, Economic Reforms. In the last video lecture, we discussed that the pillars of new economic policy 1991, and we discussed two pillars, liberalization as well as privatization. Today we will discuss the third main pillar of new economic policy, globalization. In the last video lecture, we discussed about the liberalization, and under the liberalization we studied the steps taken by government to reform different sectors like financial sector, industrial sector, fiscal sector, trade and investment sector, tax. So these all we studied in the last video lecture. Under the industrial sector, government liberalized, they allowed the private companies to set up, FDI increased around 51%. Under the financial sector, the role of RBI is converted from controller to facilitator. Many private banks were allowed in India that have given ultimately benefits to the consumers by their different kind of benefits like interest rate on the FDs or other things. Under the tax reforms, we saw that how government decreased the direct taxes as well as simplified the taxation system of India, for example GST. Trade and investment policy, government removed all kind of restrictions, quantitative as well as qualitative, means that tariff and quota system. And ultimately the main aim of government was to make such an environment where there will be the competition, to promote the competition, which will ultimately for the welfare of the economy. After that, in the privatization, we saw that how government allowed the private enterprises in the setup of industries. For the PSUs also, we saw that privatization can be promoted through two ways. The first one is that transfer of ownership, and second one is that disinvestment. Government has also given a special status to the PSUs, those were Navratna, Maharatna and Mini Ratnas. And ultimately the performance of the PSUs improved as they have given more autonomy to take their decisions. And ultimately the economy of India improved in comparison to 1990 situation. Today we will study the third pillar, that is the globalization, as well as we will see the role of World Trade Organization and the appraisal of the new economic policy. So let's start. Globalization. So globalization means integrating the national economy with the world economy through removal of barriers on international trade and capital movements. Simply, the globalization means that integration of economies. There should not be any kind of barriers among different economies. And that was the primary aim of globalization. That is written here, the main aim, or it aims to create a borderless world. There should not be any kind of border, not in the political aspect, but in the economical aspect. There must not be any kind of border. All the economic activities must be borderless, and there must not be any kind of restriction. That is the primary aim of globalization. However, it is a complex phenomenon. It is an outcome of the set of various policies that aim to transform the world towards greater interdependence and integration. It is associated with integration, and that's reason it is a complex phenomenon. It is not only associated with the borderless world, but there are some other various policies which ultimately the main aim of those policies for the greater interdependence and integration. Nowadays, not a single economy is independent. All the economies are interdependent. They cannot fulfill all the desires of their own people, and for that they are totally depend upon the other countries. So the main aim of globalization to provide them equal opportunities to all the economies. By that they ultimately promote interdependence as well as integration in an equal manner. As in the last video lecture, we saw that what were the main steps were taken by government for the globalization. For example, for the foreign direct investment, government allowed 51%, around 51% investment. Then we saw that government allowed the private banks to set up in India. Then we saw that government also allowed the disinvestment policy. Government started the disinvestment policy. These all the steps that those were taken by the government under liberalization and privatization ultimately promote the globalization. But there is a mix of thinking for the globalization. There are some positive traits as well as there are some negative traits. Positive traits such as greater access to global world. After the globalization in India, the first positive trait is that greater access to global market. Now you can purchase any kind of goods from the different parts of world. For example, Apple iPhone, you can purchase it, but prior to 1991 it was not so simple to purchase it. Advanced technology, now we are experiencing as well as we are utilizing the advanced technology, the smartphones and other electronics. So it only happened after the globalization. Third one, better future prospects for large industries of developing countries. In developing countries, the main problem was that the growth of industrialization and service sector. But after the globalization, it provided a very good future prospect for the industries of the developing countries. For example, in our country, there is a Tata Group, Reliance Group. You are aware what is the growth of these industries. Besides this, there are certain negative traits also. First, benefits of globalization accrue more to developed countries. This is the first negative trait of globalization, is that after globalization, it benefited to everyone, but more accrue more for the developed countries, not the developing countries. It ultimately benefited more to the developed countries. Second one, globalization compromises the welfare and identity of people belonging to poor countries, and due to this factor it compromises the welfare of the nations as well as welfare of the people of the poor countries. For example, the case of African countries or South Asian countries. Market-driven globalization increases economic disparity among nations and the people. And globalization is a kind of free economy. There is no control of government. Mostly there is no control of government. And it ultimately creates a disparity among the citizen of a country on the basis of their economic status. Rich became more rich and poor became more poor, as well as among the nations. The rich countries or developed countries are growing more and more, whereas poor countries are not able to compete with the developed countries. So these are some negative traits of the globalization. Besides this, globalization has also given some more other chances that we will study. Outsourcing. Outsourcing is one of the term that arrived mostly after 1991, after globalization. What is the meaning of outsourcing? So it refers to contracting out some of its activities to a third party, which were earlier performed by the organization. What is the meaning of that? Contracting out some of its activities. For any organization, there is a various kind of activities, and any organization always trying to get more benefit in the less cost. So for that, few activities were now given on a contractual basis to third party companies, which will ultimately help for the MNCs. For example, in India, many companies are hiring security services from any third party, and that benefits those MNCs. In India, there are many outsourcing businesses. Some examples, for example, voice-based outsourcing like BPO, KPO, or call center, video recording, then accountancy, banking services, film editing, etc. So now India became a hub of outsourcing. Why? Because India provides the favorable conditions for the outsourcing, and these two favorable conditions are, first one, low wage rate that will be good for the cost reduction, and second one is that availability of the skilled manpower. India became a hub after 1991. Why? Because two main categories are available in India. The first one is that low wage rate, and second one is that availability of the skilled manpower, and that attracts the MNCs towards India and for the outsourcing businesses. It also generated the employment and it benefited the economy. I hope that you understood. You can also note it down. You can pause the video and you can note it down all the important points. Now move towards the next topic, that is the World Trade Organization. I'm just erasing it. World Trade Organization, WTO. So World Trade Organization was set up in 1995. It was set up in 1995 as the successor of GATT. G-A-T-T. GATT means General Agreement on Trade and Tariff. This was one organization which was set up in 1948, and there were 23 countries of 23 membering countries of this organization. The main aim of this organization is that to look after the multilateral trade among these 23 countries and to promote a integration. Means that removal of the trade barriers. There must be one kind of free trade. So that was promoted through GATT. Later, after 1990, in 1995, this GATT is transformed into the World Trade Organization, WTO. Now, right now there are 164 membering countries or members of WTO. Before studying this, there are few terms. One is that bilateral trade. Bilateral trade means that trade in between two countries known as bilateral trade. Multilateral trade. Multilateral trade means that trade among more than two countries known as the multilateral trade. Next term is that tariff barriers. Tariff barriers means that all kind of barriers, quantitative restrictions over export and import known as the tariff barriers. Non-tariff barriers, qualitative restrictions over export and import known as the non-tariff barrier, that you also known as the quota. So the main work of WTO was to promote the free trading of, or you can say the free multilateral trade among these 164 countries which are the member of the WTO, and to promote globalization. All the countries access the same opportunities of trade. This is the main aim of the World Trade Organization. It look after the agreement of multilateral trade among the membering countries and providing them equal opportunities. India is also a member of WTO, and India is always in the forefront to safeguard the opportunities of developing countries. Now we will study the functions of WTO. What are the main functions? The first main function of WTO is that to facilitate trade. To facilitate trade. Through removal of trade barriers. The first main function of WTO is that to facilitate the trade through removal of the trade barriers. If there will be any kind of trade barrier, so that ultimately not give the equal opportunities to both countries or all those countries which are doing the trade. So the first function of WTO is that to facilitate the trade. Second one is that to provide equal opportunities to all countries or nations. The second function of WTO is that to provide them equal opportunities. There must not be any kind of exploitation of developing countries by the developed countries. there must be equal opportunities among the developed countries as well as developing countries. This is the second function of WTO. Third one, to enlarge production and trade of services. The third function of WTO is that to enlarge the production and trade. Fourth one, to ensure optimum utilization of resources. And the last one, to protect the environment. So these are the main functions of WTO. The first one is that to facilitate trade, and how the trade can be facilitated when all kind of barriers will be removed. So the first work of the WTO is that to remove the trade barriers and to promote liberalization, to liberalize the economies. Second one, to provide equal opportunities to all countries. There must be equal opportunity to all countries, developed countries or the developing countries, rich countries or the poor countries. Third one, to enlarge the production and trade, to expand the trade, that is the third function. Fourth one, to ensure optimum utilization of resources. Whatever the resources are available in the country, that must be used in the proper way with efficiency. And the last one is that to protect the environment. Whatever the resources will be utilized, that must not be exploitation of resources, whereas it is based on the sustainable development policy. So these are the main functions of WTO. So India also became the member of WTO in 1995 when it was set up. But in reality, from these functions, in reality, there is a much problem in the WTO, as there is an argument over on WTO that WTO is promoting the developed countries' rights and they are neglecting the developing countries' rights. That's reason a question arises that should India be a member of WTO? I'm just raising it. Should India be a member of WTO? So, according to some scholars, India should not be the member of WTO. Why? There is a reason. As I told you that there are many scholars or many countries, they are giving the obligation, they are arguing that WTO is promoting the rights of the developed countries and they are neglecting the rights of the developing countries. India is also a developing country. So the first reason is that India should not be, according to some scholars, India should not be the part of WTO, because major volume of international trade
occurs among the developed countries. And the second reason is that developing countries has countries are being cheated as on one side WTO urge to developing countries to open their countries and remove trade barriers and on the other side developed countries imposing trade barriers on the goods and services of developing countries. So these are the two main reasons behind that India should not be a member of WTO. Some scholars think that because major volume of the international trade that is controlled by the developed countries in all over the world, most of the MNCs belongs to these developed countries and they control major volume of international trade. The percentage of involvement of the developing countries is quite negligible, very less if we will compare to the developed countries. And second one is that developing countries are being cheated. Why developing countries are being cheated? Because WTO promotes that to provide equal opportunities to all the countries. But what happening in reality? Developed countries, WTO urges to the all the developing countries that to remove their trade barriers and open their market. Whereas developed countries are imposing the tax tariff over the import of goods from the developing countries. So this is a partial approach of WTO towards the developing countries. It means that WTO is only promoting the rights of developed countries and they are neglecting the developing countries, and that's the reason India should not be a member of WTO. Now, after the WTO, we will analyze the new economic policies. As we know that any kind of system is not always perfect, and that is also with new economic policy. And that's reason there is a mix of thinking about the new economic policy. Our next topic is an appraisal. New economic policy 1991. So regarding the new economic policy, there is a mix of thinking about it. Some are in the favor of new economic policy and some are criticizes the new economic policy. So let's analyze it. First, arguments in the favor of new economic policy. So I will write it here. The first one is that increase in rate of economic growth. Rate of economic growth. So the first argument in favor of new economic policy is that after new economic policy, the economic growth of India increase. And how we can say that? Because in 1991, the GDP growth rate was growth rate of GDP was 5.6%, which increased in 2017-18 by 6.7%, and this is the main reason that some scholars are thinking due to the new economic policy, the growth rate of GDP increased. The second one, inflow of foreign investment. Inflow of foreign investment. This was the main reason behind the adoption of the new economic policy, because there was the fall in the foreign exchange reserve in 1991. But when India adopted the new economic policy, so foreign investment inflow in our country, and it raised from $100 million in 1992 to 321 billion dollar as per 73.5 billion dollar in 2014-15. So this is the major change in case of foreign investment, and it also raised the foreign exchange reserves. This is the second reason in favor of the new economic policy. Now the third one, same, rise in foreign exchange reserve. So foreign exchange reserve in India reached after the adoption of the new economic policy. Next one is that rise in export. Earlier it was foreign exchange reserve was $6 billion. Now it is $321 billion as per 2014-15. In September 2014, government launched Making India movement, and that also liberalized the market of India, and that ultimately increased the inflow of foreign investment in India by 48%. So when foreign investment raised in India, so that also raised the foreign exchange reserves. Next one is that control on inflation. Control on inflation. So with the help of new economic policy, government ultimately succeed in the control of inflation, because in 1991 the inflation rate was 17%, and that was decreased in 2015-16 by, and now it become 5.6%, around 5.6%. So by that we can say government succeed to control the inflation after the new economic policy. Another argument in favor: rise in export. Export sector of India is also got success, as export from India reached after 1991. Electronics, IT, outsourcing, medicine, in other sectors also the export from India raised, and these are the main arguments in favor of new economic policy. And we also know that after 1991 private sector allowed to set up their industries, and now many renowned MNCs, they set up their plants and industry in our country, like Samsung recently they set up their mobile manufacturing plant in India. So these are the main arguments in favor of new economic policy. But there is also some criticism of the new economic policy, and first of all I will erase it. Criticisms of new economic policy. So many scholars, they criticizes the new economic policy and the steps those were taken under the new economic policy. The first one is that growing unemployment. This is true that after 1991 the growth rate of GDP raised, but at some part of it also promoted the unemployment in Indian economy. The industries those were set up, that also decreased the job security. And after 1991, around 93% of people in India, they were engaged in unorganized sector, and only 7% of people, they engaged in the organized sector. Their job is in the organized sector. So by that you can understand what was the main criticism, that is the growing unemployment. Second one, neglect agriculture sector. After 1991, government removed all the import duties, and due to that the Indian farmers, they face a stiff competition from the foreign imported agricultural products, as well as government, they reduce the subsidy from agricultural products, they remove the minimum support price, they reduce the money from the infrastructural development, that was one of the part of the Green Revolution, and it totally neglected the agricultural sector of India. And now the Indian farmers, they face lot of competition from the foreign countries. Third one, low level of industrial growth. Prior to 1991, India adopted the inward looking strategy to protect the domestic industries from the foreign industries. But after 1991, India liberalized their economy, liberalized their market, and due to that, now the domestic producers, they faced a competition from the cheap foreign imported goods. For example, in India, the Chinese goods, that ultimately they forced the domestic producers to decrease their production or to shut down their plants. So this is the one of the reason that why that we can say the industrial growth in India is not up to the mark as they considered during the planning. Beside this, in India there is a lack of infrastructural facilities, there is a problem of power, electricity, and one more reason behind it, that developed countries, they are demanding from WTO that developing countries should remove their barriers, but in against developed countries, they are imposing the taxes over the import of goods. For example, Indian cotton goods, in America there is a tax over the Indian cotton goods. So this is a kind of reason behind the low level of industrial growth. The next one, ineffective disinvestment policy. Government introduced disinvestment policy to improve the performance of PSUs. But many scholars, they are arguing that the government disinvestment policy was not effective, as in 2014 and 15 government decided the target for this disinvestment is 56,000 crore rupees, but the achievement was about 34,500 crore rupees. It means that the value of PSUs were not taken properly. They argued that the PSUs values were undervalued and sold to the private sector. Second one is that the disinvestment policy was not taken to facilitate the PSUs or to facilitate or to improve the performance of PSUs. Instead of it, government used the disinvestment policy to collect the revenue. So this is one of the factor or criticism of the new economic policy. Next one, ineffective tax policy. Government decreased the direct taxes and simplified the indirect taxes only to improve the condition of tax evasion, but to attract the foreign investors in India, government has gave them freedom. They set up the special economic zones, and in case of due to these policies, government revenue was not raised, and that reason, scholars argued that the tax policy of India after 1991 was not effective. Next one, unbalanced growth. The growth in India was unbalanced. It is true that most of the people who were engaged in the agricultural sector, now they migrate towards the industrial sector and service sector, but mainly the service sector in India that improved, whereas the industrial sector in India was not improved, or the improvement in industrial sector was not up to the mark as it was planned. As well as after the globalization, it also created a disparity, a gap in between the rich and the poor, in between the big industrialist and the poor peasants, and that's reason new economic policy criticizes. And the last one is spread of consumerism. After 1991, many kind of products came in the market that promoted the luxurious lifestyle and consumption of the items of superior quality, and that spread a new kind of phenomena, consumerism, in the market, and this trended in India after 1991. It also promoted that the desire of the consumers can be fulfilled, and it also created a gap between the consumers. So these are the main criticisms behind the new economic policy. Once again, let's recapitulate it. Growing unemployment. Unemployment increased in India after 1991 because most of the people were engaged in the unorganized sector. Neglect agricultural sector. Agricultural sector was totally neglected. The Indian farmers face a steep competition from the foreign imported agricultural products. Government also reduced the subsidies from the agricultural sector. Government also removed the MSP from the agricultural sector. One of the reason behind the criticism of new economic policy, low level of industrial growth. Growth in industrial sector was not up to the mark. Ineffective investment, disinvestment policy. Scholars, they argued that the disinvestment policy in India was not to improve the condition of the PSUs. Instead of, it was used to collect the revenue, as the value of PSUs were undervalued. And the main aim of the government was to collect the revenue. Ineffective tax policy was not up to the mark, because whatever the changes were created after 1991, that was only to remove the tax evasion. But to attract the foreign investors in India, government has given the freedom, and that also not up to the mark for the collection of revenue of the government. Government did not collect much revenue from it. Unbalanced growth. Mainly new economic policy was adopted for the growth in the economy. Yes, growth happened in the GDP. It raised from 5.6% to 6.7% in 2017-18, but mainly growth we can see in the service sector, not in the industrial sector. The growth in industrial sector is not up to the mark. And the last one is the spread of consumerism. Many products were launched and arrived in India that promoted the luxurious life as well as that promoted the consumption of superior quality good. That also created a gap among the consumers. I hope that you understood this, and after the completion of this you will also get one assignment. That assignment you need to send through ERP. I will request you all that to send your assignment in the PDF form instead of JPG form. And till that, be safe, be and stay at home. Thank you.